Hi, welcome to Blacticulate, a podcast series featuring UK young black professionals, where we find out how they do what they do, so you can too. Or not. After all, it is your life. Yo, hey guys, once again, thanks for joining us. Oh God, I feel like you guys are family. Well, you are family. I mean, the fact that every fortnight you tune in with us to listen to another episode of Blacticulate, where we feature UK young black professionals, and we always try our hardest to extract how-to advice, resources, tips, so you guys can too. So now guys, today's episode is amazing, as always. Tobi Oludayomi, who is the founder of Studio 14, which is a digital and mobile games agency. Now, Tobi is interesting just because he's one of those guys, how do I explain this and not do him a disservice? He's one of those guys who, whatever he takes his hand to, he just kills it. He tells us how he pretty much started up his own studio and how that sort of progressed all the way from music, and he was making music and producing beats for the likes of Wiley at one stage, and how he seizes all the networking opportunities he can. And he tells us about where the studio is going, where the growth areas are in the industry, and potentially also what it is you can do if you're looking to start up something similar. I hope that this episode, as per usual, is valuable to you. And if it's not, please give us a shout. Any feedback, any comment really goes a long way. So holla. We love you. I might have to edit that part out. But without further ado, I bring to you Tobi Oludayomi. So yeah, see you on the other side. Bye. Let's get that story in then. Okay, guys, so the voice you're hearing is Tobi Oludayomi. Oludayomi, shame on me as well, because I'm Nigerian. Oludayomi. Once again, welcome to another episode of Blacticulate. This is the first time you've ever heard of it. Thank you for joining us. And it really is all about featuring UK young black professionals, where we try to find out how they do what it is they do, so you can too. Now, Tobi,
how are you?
I'm good, mate. How are you?
I'm okay, man. Yeah. Thanks for inviting me.
No, it's a pleasure. So tell us why you're here, I guess. I mean, who are you? And let's just roll from there.
All right, guys. My name is Tobi Oludayomi. I'm Nigerian. I run a digital product studio called Studio 14. We make digital products like games and websites and software. Basically, anything digital, we can somehow get it done.
Anything digital,
I think so. We are fast learners. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
So
because we are living in the age of Internet of Things, right?
Yeah, we do. And the reason why I say almost anything is because I think it comes from my personality. I got into this not knowing anything about tech.
Okay.
I'm a music man. I'm not tech, but for some reason, somehow I made it work. So I just carry on grafting, carry on reading. I like to push people to their extremes, and then that doesn't become the extremes anymore. I think. Yeah. To the end, and then that wall breaks down and there's another end.
So of course, they say nothing great ever comes within a comfort zone.
Exactly.
So you're always trying to expand your comfort zone.
Exactly.
Right?
And I love when people learn new things. Okay. So most of the guys that are with us, they were not the brightest at the start. When I say brightest, I mean they were not.
You're talking about your staff?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
They were not as in at that level. We never hired somebody who was like the sixth developer in the world.
Right.
They had potential and they were good at what they did. And then we just threw them in the deep end.
Okay, well, let's start from scratch, right? Because as you guys can hear, Tobi owns a digital agency called Studio 14, but it'll be quite interesting to know how you started that. But, like, background, hit us. Like, what was growing up like?
Growing up was fun.
Yeah?
Where did
you grow up?
I was born in Nigeria.
Okay.
I lived there for about 9 or 10 years.
19 years?
No, 9 or 10 years.
Okay,
no,
gotcha.
9 or 10 years. For about half of those years, life was good. The other half, not so good.
Why?
It's just things weren't working out for my parents, man.
Okay.
So eventually, they decided to move to, because my mum was born here, so they decided to move to England.
Right.
And then when we came to England, everything just, we basically had to start from scratch, really.
But, no doubt, yeah. It's funny because, like, I mean, being myself, British Nigerian, like, when it comes down to us and where we are in a class structure in Nigeria, would say we're affluent, middle, upper, right? But the moment you come into England or London, you're working class.
Degree doesn't count.
Yeah, yeah.
My dad had to be, dude, I love my dad. He, when he came here, he was a businessman. So for the couple of years that business weren't working, he rode through that.
Right.
And then his business had to pick up again.
Okay, what's his and business?
He had a construction company.
Okay.
And then we decided to move. So it wasn't, we moved when he was still broke. We moved when he had money. Right. But when he moved over here, he had to start from scratch. His degree didn't come. Mom's an accountant. Then she's a genius. She had to start from scratch. They both had to go to uni again.
Oh, really?
He worked as a postman. He worked as YMCA. He worked as everything you can possibly think of just to make ends meet while he was doing his uni again. And then eventually graduated and he got back to where he was. And now he's retired at 50-something. So
amazing.
Both of them, actually.
Yeah. So they're definitely your role models.
Yeah, definitely. Him and my granddad.
Amazing. Amazing. Okay, so you've moved from Nigeria at the age of 9 to 10. With yourself, your parents, your brother, sisters?
I have three brothers.
We
have four boys. My dad calls us the Consumer Association. They consume every single food he buys in the house. So,
consume.
Literally, that's what it calls
Association. I like that.
Well, the four of us, no girls.
Okay. Mom, are you all relatively close in age and even just...
My older brother's 30, so he's 4 years older than me. And then it's just... 26, me 24 and 22.
Oh, wow.
So we're quite close.
So the fact that your parents and themselves were struggling, I guess, to live a certain lifestyle they wanted to in Niger, they decided, you know what, let's go to the UK, we're going to start from bottoms up. And they did that.
My dad actually went a couple of months ahead of us.
Right.
Obviously to try and get work or decent, because he had a friend here who had a business, so I think the friend gave him work. But so he prepared before we came. There was already a house for us, so everything was fine.
Oh,
and I think
amazing.
To be honest, it was his sister lived here, my mom's brothers lived here, so they were people.
So he knew he had a network.
Yeah, definitely.
So it wasn't like he went cold.
Because my mom lived here for like 6-7 years when she was born, anyway, and so they've always been like coming back and forth. So it's never been just a strange land to them.
Right.
But we had never been, so we'd never been at that time. But in Nigeria. A lot of the times were good. Even in Nigeria, if you had no money, as long as there's sun in the sky, you're outside.
I love that. So long as the weather is good, right?
Yeah, you're outside playing football, doing this kid stuff. And because we were really close, we always had each other. I think that kind of shaped my mentality, what's giving me drive and what's giving me the appreciation of just little things.
Can you speak on that? What do you mean?
I wouldn't say, to be honest, there are certain times where we didn't have food, put it that way. It didn't happen all the time, but there are certain times we didn't have food. Certain times when things just didn't work out. So nowadays, my entire life now is based around helping others. I want to genuinely hopefully God willing, I will just eradicate poverty from the entire face of Nigeria. That's my vision.
Right.
I have big dreams, by the way.
No, for sure. Please.
So... even from now, the company sponsors children. We give a percentage of our profits to charity. As in, we do as much as we can to help the poor or the needy, whatever it is, in different parts of the world. In the UK, in Nigeria, in Africa, all over the world, to be honest. So all of that came from because of the situation I grew up in.
So let's start narrowing it down a bit, if I can, just to get your story, Tobi. So my man is now officially in the UK, right? Yeah. Courtesy of your dad paving the way, bringing your mother and the boys through,
definitely.
Right? You four boys, consumer associations.
Yeah.
So where did you live when you came in and what was school like?
We lived in London first.
Right.
And then we moved to Birmingham. At that time, London was a hotspot in terms of violence and children and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, okay.
And we lived in like Crystal Palace, Peckham area.
Right. So Peckham.
So he moved to Birmingham. And to be honest, when we moved to Birmingham, life was good. As in, if you were in London right now, just move to Birmingham. As in, it's cheap, the houses are nice, and it was just a good place. So when we were growing up there, we had a decent sized house. Our school was.
What was the school?
School Holy Lodge, my secondary school.
Okay.
The first time I saw a Sikh person.
Oh, okay.
Because, you know, obviously in Nigeria, you don't have Sikh, and even in some parts of London, you don't really see them, especially where we stayed. But in Birmingham, there's a lot of Asians. Right. So when I first saw a Sikh person, normally they tie their turban in like a circular way, but his was like a top knot.
Okay.
Yeah. And this was in PE, and he was in the boys' change rooms. I was thinking, is this a boy or is this a girl? Because when he took off his turban, his hair was so long. So it took me a couple of seconds to figure out if this is a boy or not. And then I was like, oh crap, it is a boy. I will never forget that day in my life. But that was the first time I've ever seen a Sikh person with a top knot.
Yeah, someone who is starkly different.
Yeah, exactly. That woke me up.
Yeah. Was it quite multicultural though, your school?
I say 45% Asian, and then the rest mixed with black and white and every other ethnicity. But yeah, it was definitely an urban school, let's put it that way. Yeah. But it was a lovely school, from the fights to the football to the playtime. Literally everything was interracial.
Right. So you never felt like isolated with your race or as a black person? So you never really... Because a lot of us, right, and this is when I speak to a lot of my guests, I always almost ask them, well, when was the first time you felt, you know, your blackness? When was the first time? Do you have a story behind that? We all know we're black, let's not be around the bush, but to be felt like you are other and lesser, that in itself is an issue. So I was wondering, do you have a story like that?
I think because of the school I went to, I didn't have that. Amazing. But I had mine, I would say, when I first started my business.
Okay.
So further down the line.
So join the dots for me. So now you've been school Holly Lodge in Birmingham. It's a secondary school. Then you go into college?
Or sixth form.
Sixth form. Yeah. Or did you study?
Obviously, my parents are Nigerian, so I had to go study something like accounting or something like that.
Right.
But yeah, I work hard. But I wouldn't say I'm the brightest kid on the block. As in, I'm not stupid, but I'm not a genius. I'm in the middle, but I work hard. So I didn't get fantastic grades in GCSE. I think I got like Bs and...
So you're a B D's. Student?
Yeah, or yeah. D. What, in the Nigerian household, there's nothing like a B student. But I think my parents knew I worked hard, so they, there was nothing wrong with it. They were happy.
Yeah.
And
your elder brother, a day student?
Yeah, he got A's.
Oh, man.
So even my younger brother got A's.
Oh, no.
But I think because they saw that I worked hard and they saw that my gifts are not intellectually all the time, so maybe it's working hard or being driven. So that's the reason I love my parents. They never compare us and they know the different person's strengths from different person's weaknesses. So there's never a comparison.
Amazing.
But so when I left there, I went to college and then I had to, they allowed me to study sports. I say allow. I studied accounting and business studies.
Okay.
So that was kind of...
That start to get your mind into the business acumen aspect, I assume. And then you graduated, naturally, and you decided to go to university. Again, I assume your parents wanted you to go through this passage of education. Or did you want to do it for yourself?
I didn't think there was any other option.
Okay.
It wasn't that they forced me, but I did want to go.
Right.
Apart from the fact I wanted to leave the house. I did want to go and just see what the world was like and actually study something. Right. But there was a turning point between those 2 years.
Okay.
Obviously, they still wanted me to go and do something like law or accounting or something. But while I was in college, I started to build my production skills. Music production,
okay. And then what tools? Do you remember?
Started with Fruity Loops, went to Reason, Logic.
Dang.
Listen, you name it, I used it, man. Just put it on me.
Okay.
I remember the time when, because my house, because it's a different house by now, we had pink carpets.
Pink?
Yes.
Carpet?
Pink carpet. You know what, it's actually really nice. It's not as bad as it sounds. It's really nice. But my mom would hate people coming in the house because obviously I had I built a recording studio in my bedroom.
Right.
So random is, quotation, gangsters, bad boys, everybody used to come in the house to record the tracks.
Right, yeah.
And she used to hate it because obviously the fact that just random ones are coming to the house and just dirty shoes on the carpet. And so every time someone, like, you see a roadman coming out the door and I'm like, take your shoes off. So they take the shoes off, they're coming to my bedroom and they record. So that started to go on. I started to make some money.
Amazing.
When I started to make some money, then I had a leg to stand on to my parents thinking, let me go and study media technology at university. There's something in it. I already have some cash to prove it.
Mm.
And they could see how passionate I was about it. So they said, you know what? If that's what you want to do, that's what you want to do.
Nah, I like that. That's it. That's amazing. So when you built your studio, just through word of mouth, or were you actually trying to promote it to say, do you guys want to record a record, come to me?
Initially it was word of mouth, and then obviously that's when social media started to pick up. So you had MySpace, you had all them things. So yeah, we used a lot of online tools.
In your own house, making a business, a studio.
My younger brother, the one that we founded Studio 14, he then picked up graphic design. Right. So he used to do all the artwork,
the covers,
and
for the
albums, and like photography and all those kind of things. So we've always been like the team from day one. I did the recording and the music production. He do the artwork and the album.
Amazing.
So you print the flyers and leave it on the buses and all those kind of things.
Do you remember your first client?
Yes.
Okay. Tell me, for
music production?
Yeah.
My first beat I sold it for £25. Back then, it was a lot of money to me. £25, and it wasn't even true. I listened to it now; it was disgusting. It was a crap beat.
Still, £25. How did you sell it, or how did you even price yourself?
I don't know. I genuinely don't know. I think I remember who I sold it to. I don't even know how I met him, but I think he came to record one day, and we were just playing some beats, and he said he liked it, and I said I'll sell it to you, and then that's how I performed my first beat.
Did you get royalties for any of these?
Nah. I get royalties for things I've done down the line, but these ones, I don't even know what they did with the tune at all.
Okay. So now I get it. I mean, you've already got your studio. You're pretty much now in love with music. So you thought music technology at uni?
Definitely, 100%. Okay. And I went to Kiel University. I'm not sure if you've heard of it. It's in Stoke-on-Trent.
Okay.
Like in between Manchester and Birmingham. Yeah. The best university in the world.
Okay.
I think there was a survey a couple of days ago that said Kiel has the highest student satisfaction rate and the highest of graduates in employment.
Really?
When I was there anyway, it was genuinely the best time of my life. People used to go to lectures in the PJs.
That's insane.
So
a good uni to you, someone that could go to
it was
that. Lecture in the PJs.
It was so different.
Yeah. Okay, interesting. So you graduated, sir, and then what was your next step? Because we're now slowly but surely getting into Studio 14.
My brother actually came to the same uni with me.
Did he?
Because it was that good of a uni. Because obviously when I was there, him and my younger brother, they used to come and visit for a while and play football. And
mess around in halls.
As in we had, because it was like a countryside uni. So the summertime was beautiful. Mm. Just barbecues, football, rugby, everything you call it, you can name it in the fields we did. So they would come in the summertime. So obviously he fell in love with uni as well. And then he came. So when I left university, and like I said, I wanted to carry on with music, but all of a sudden everything just dried up.
Right.
It just absolutely dried up.
When you say dried up, was it still successful throughout uni?
Yeah, no, to be honest, my most successful time was at uni.
Okay.
That's when I met.
Because you had all the equipment and stuff.
Obviously I studied it, so I knew a lot more of what I was doing.
Right.
I had access to recording studios that were world class. Right. I could bring people down. By that time, Facebook and things like that were already
SoundCloud.
Yeah, so I could reach a lot more people. I remember the first time I spoke to Wiley, he was on.
Wiley?
Yeah.
Damn, my man just name dropped like that. Yeah, okay.
No, just to show you the power of social media, I was on, I was in my bedroom actually at university, and he was in Australia, and he was doing like a webcam session in his studio, and he was just talking to people. And then I told him, I was like, because I already had an email from, a manager or something, and I said, I sent you a couple of
emails. You've made that too flippant. You had his email from where?
From, I think, his manager. Because with social media, because as a rapper, you always want beats.
Right, gotcha.
So it's never, you never turn down beats ever, because that could be your next hit. So they were always open to receiving beats.
Right.
But Wiley is a special character. Everybody sent him beats, so it's hard to get in touch with him. But I messaged, I said, I sent you beats, listen to it. And he didn't say anything, obviously, because too many people were messaging. And I said, are you scared to listen to my... So basically, I was taunting him.
Right.
I said, because he was rapping to a song in the studio and we could hear it. And then I said, my beats are better than that. And then he said, who's this person?
Ballsy, yeah.
And I said, who's this person? And then we started talking through the chat. And then I sent it to beats again to him. And then he played it live on air. And then he went crazy. And then within half an hour, he recorded a song. All live on the webcam.
Right.
He called me, recorded the song, he sent me the song, and that's our thing.
Can you name drop the song?
It never got released.
Oh, it never got released.
Music is a funny thing, man. It never got released, but obviously it opened a lot more doors for me.
Right.
And it's called Beach Party.
So you saw this as your career. You're loving it. You're in the middle of it, in a sense where you're getting now big names like Wiley, amongst others. You know, asking for beats by Tobi. Did you have a specific alias?
Skills Beats.
Skills Beats. Yeah.
I'm so ashamed of that name.
Yeah.
my skills beat. Yeah, it's amazing. And then you said you graduated from uni and then it just all dried up.
It just dried up, literally. People just start answering my calls. Nobody was buying anymore. I literally just dried up.
Yeah, that's curious. So,
and there was actually one time where it was, I was doing well, but this would have been the peak. Because have you heard of a movie called Street Dance 2?
Yeah.
Yeah. At that time, I was making a song for that movie.
Right.
So, like I said, everything was going fantastic. And all of a sudden, hit the wall. Nothing happened anymore.
And you're not curious to know what it was you did wrong, whether your strategy...
I don't think I did anything wrong. Because the same things I've been doing, your work talks for you. My music spoke for me. It was really good. I got into the doors in the first place, but nothing ever came of it. So when it got to that stage, I was thinking, hold on, is the same thing happening over and over again? I was like, nah, this must be God. I'm not meant to be doing this. Or I said, forget it.
Okay, well... That's fascinating, Toby. You're a fascinating guy. So tell me then, from then you, all of a sudden, music's dried up. Where's your headspace? What are you thinking? How are we finding ourselves now at Studio 14?
I was, 21 at that time. My brother had gone back to uni then. So in the summer times, we did a lot more music and studio work. But when he went back to uni, it was just me and my own at home. Right. So everybody would go to work, I'm at home, my own. You could hear the clock, you know, them times it was just so dead. So you're there with your own thoughts trying to think of, as they told me to apply for jobs, I was like, no, I'm not gonna apply for jobs. But I applied for one job, a sales job. I got called to I won't call it interview, more like an assessment day.
Right.
I hated it so much. Right. It was like, it felt like me betraying me. And then from that day, I was like, nope, I don't care what nobody says to me, I'm not applying for any job ever again.
And so you said that to your parents?
Well, I don't think I said it that way. But
wait, when that Omorogu come out, you're not too old to get a spanking, trust.
Definitely not too old in my household. That mentality anyway, I was like, no, it's not happening anymore. And then my mom, lucky enough actually, my mom, I think they've always seen it in me. So they will never push me to do something.
Especially your dad being a businessman.
My granddad been very successful. So it's,
and your granddad as well. So the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. So he must recognize when there's an entrepreneurial spirit and a businessman in the making, which is clearly you.
That's the truth, to be honest. Yeah. I didn't think of it that way, but that is the truth. So when my mom, she used to work in the Birmingham City Council as an accountant, a man came to speak called Eric McMean about people who want to get out of 9-to-5 and start their own business. So she was obviously very fascinated. She kept thinking about me when we were talking. So she told me to go and see him. And then I was going to see him. We hit off. And then I said, mate, you have a rubbish logo. I'll make you a new one. And he laughed. And that same day, I went back to uni. Because obviously, I still had a lot of friends in uni. So I used to go back to uni. And my brother was there as well.
Yeah.
So I went back to uni. I was like, listen, let's start a logo design company. I was speaking to this guy and he was giving me different ideas and he was saying that we should start something that requires no capital whatsoever. So I said, why don't we start a logo design company where you can go online and order a logo and in 48 hours or in less than a week or something, a very short space of time, small amount of money, you can get your logo. So he said, yeah, why not? So we basically made a website. But before we made a website that day, I told him to recreate a logo for the business coach and literally sent it to him. He was shocked. He loved it. He rebranded his whole company based on
amazing. So that was almost your first client, but it was pro bono.
But then he became my mentor. So that's how that's how that relationship started. The first company was called The Logo Man.
The Logo Man.
Yes, straight to the point.
You've got your names unlocked.
The Logo Man.
Skill set. Logo Man. Go
ahead. So it was just basically straightforward. You go on the website, you pick different kind of packages, and you order your logo, and we get it done for you. You pay on PayPal. And we had a friend.
So it was you and your brother.
It was me and my brother, but then we had a friend who helped us develop the website.
Right.
So that's it. So that's the first company.
From there, how many clients did you have?
All right, so he was at uni.
Yeah.
Obviously, you can't really do too much when he was single in the second year.
Right.
So he could only do so much. So I started to learn how to design because obviously the clientele got a bit bigger and bigger and bigger.
Of course, and they're looking for the turnaround within a week.
Exactly. Stupid idea that I was thinking to myself, why would I do it in 2 days? So I had to learn how to design. I eventually got pretty good. And then we did something.
I'm listening.
There was a website called Huddlebyte. It's like a business version of Groupon.
Okay.
And we got 32 customers in the space of a couple of days or a week.
32.
32. And there's no way we can do that for 18 locos. Yeah. I don't know how many days.
Within 48 hours.
So we had to tell people that, listen, mate, it's been overwhelming, to give us a bit of time. So we're just turning out logos, turning out designs. And then they started coming back for more. We want a website. We want a business
branding
card.
Branding package entirely.
And obviously, at that time, I didn't know anything about business. Pricing was overly cheap. But we were excited because we were getting some sort of money.
Yeah.
And then it just kind of organically grew from there. And then we said, you know what? The world is going digital. This logo thing, this is fun, but there's not enough money in it. We're a lot better than we're charging.
Right.
So why don't we make a premium company, or you could call it premium, that does similar things, which is Studio 14. And then that was then when we started to actually get into the digital
space.
Yeah, space. Yeah. Our first big project, actually, because obviously, like I said, I'm from music background, so I knew quite a few people. So we helped Leaf will be develop an app.
Amazing.
It's called that. You know when you had the little catchphrases?
Ow.
Then tuna, all those kind of things. Yeah. So we made a little soundboard app for him, like about 100,000 downloads. So again, that just
you made a soundboard app that got 100,000 downloads.
On the copy, I think, yeah, on both platforms.
That is insane.
And that was when we first launched Studio 14. So it kind of gave us a bit of credibility in a way.
Amazing.
And then things just started to kind of move on,
build
organically.
Itself. So I don't want anyone who's listened to think, well, Toby's lucky or that.
Yeah,
just,
I am.
You know.
I'm well, not going to lie.
Well,
I am.
Well, you say that, but I think you capitalize on opportunities that are presented to you. So if you don't have the mind frame or the vision to see it, then every opportunity will just go by, won't it?
That's true.
But I'm just curious to know how you sustain yourself. So now we understand how it came to fruition of your company, but how are you getting clients? How are you sustaining yourself? What is your, I guess, if you can, give us any of, like, you know, your strategies, your marketing tips, your...
We obviously have business plans now. We have, what's it called, growth plans.
Is that you writing it, you and your brother, or
me?
You found someone else?
Okay. No, it's me. So, like I said, I had to learn a lot. I have had to learn a lot. And because of that, it's forced me, or I don't say forced, it's made me like learning, and it's made me like when other people learn, because I know what it's going to do for them in the long run.
Right.
So as I started to read, I started to learn, I started to speak to people and
learning about business.
Yes,
right.
the financial side of business, the processes, the strategies, all those kind of things. I still don't know a lot.
Any books you can recommend?
I don't actually read books.
Okay. Was it just internet articles?
Yeah, most of them were business books, but not...
Any specific names? Because I'm just trying to, again, from my audience perspective, those who are listening, I want them to go, oh, okay, Toby's just like me in a similar sort of background upbringing, and he's like, he's reading these articles. Let me go check them out.
There's a platform that I use. It's called Ucademy or something.
Yeah, like, Ucademy. Yeah.
Yeah. So I have used that a lot to kind of teach myself certain things.
Yeah. So Ucademy is pretty much like a teach and learning platform.
Yeah.
There's Khan Academy. There's a plethora of these sort of free resources.
The one on LinkedIn, what's it called? Is it Lynda?
Lynda, L-Y-N-D-A, lynda.com. Some of these are where you have to have like a subscription and you have to pay, but most of the courses, honestly, guys, you can find on YouTube.
Oh, definitely.
It's just that good. So, okay, brilliant. Well, you see, it's one of those things that you knew you had to step up.
Yeah.
You had to learn this, and so you were learning this. Now, this kind of then brings me onto your strategy. If you don't mind sharing, like, what is it you're doing consistently ensure that the bottom line is met? Because you have to pay yourself. Maybe it might be a minimum. You have to pay your brother. You have staff. Do you have a brick and mortar? You actually have an office?
Yeah, I have an office.
So there's rent, there's overhead.
And that just keeps going up.
Does it? Holy smoke. So tell me about that. Like, where's your office? Like, yeah, what? Okay, so this is what really excites me, right? So, Toby, you and your brother, you're like, let's do this. Do you know? Mm. You might have spoken to your parents, you might have spoken to everyone, and they were like, you know what, we've got work for you through aunties, uncles, the likes of, you're like, okay, brilliant. It's going to charge you this. We're going to charge you that. It's going to be obviously fluid and organic. So we now need staff, I'm assuming. That's what your first thing, or was it we need a building?
The products have always been bigger than me and my brother because they were the techie side of things. We were more creative.
Right.
So we had, like I said, a friend from university. We had him
build that website originally. Yeah.
We had him as a freelancer, and we had a couple of freelancers. So for a year or so, actually, we still use freelancers today. But for a while, they were our main
go to?
Yeah, so not employees, direct employees, but yeah, they're our main freelancers. Yeah. Yes,
in you use them as
so what as obviously that got a lot more, then we thought, you know, we need to get an office. And then we got an office.
Amazing. How did that feel?
It was exciting. It was really exciting. But at the same time, I realized that now I have to do work.
Yeah.
As in, before, we had a lot, before the office, you have a lot more disposable income.
Right.
So you could do whatever you want. But now things, structures have to come in place.
Okay.
So when you have bills to pay, you change your mindset.
Of course.
So that was, it was a very good awakening, let's put it that way. Our office is cool, man. We're like a tiny little mini Google. We have like table tennis table, basketball net.
Why? Why do you have all of that?
Because the work we do, as in, you can spend the whole day trying to sort a problem out and be frustrated with it. But as soon as you let your head down, play a bit of table tennis, forget about it. By the time you come back, your brain will sort it out for you.
Mm.
And that's happened many a times.
Amazing, okay.
So you have to be relaxed. And creativity doesn't, you can't force creativity.
Yeah.
As in, there's some days where you're sitting down there trying to design a logo for hours, days, nothing's coming out. But when you're not thinking about it, or when you're not forcing yourself, you just put pen to paper and that's it, you made a brilliant masterpiece. So
that in itself is quite telling. So your habit or pattern is you have to walk away from the problem, try and relax your mind in any way possible, and then come back to it, and it normally resolves itself.
Most likely, most of the time. So that's why we're very chilled, and we encourage being chilled. And that's what a lot of places do, it because it makes sense.
So here's a question then. Oh, actually, we haven't even finished with the strategies, have we? Sorry, no, I'm just now really fascinated. Like, go on, Tobi. So you're saying that you read a lot, you know, particularly you're going on Ucademy to understand business strategies and planning for whenever you're going for investors. You've got your brick and mortar now. You've got office, table tennis, you know, basketball. Now you've got contractors because a lot of the projects now are bigger than just yourself and your brother. Now you've got the responsibilities of making sure that these overheads are met. What are the challenges? And are they larger or lesser because of your race?
Open up a kind of worms.
No, I mean, this is candid conversations, man.
Okay, that's a good question. All right, so in terms of the strategies, when we moved to the office, obviously, everything was still going well in Nigeria. Everything was fine. We didn't ever lack, let's put it that way.
Gotcha.
But then when it started to dry up, we had to come back into the UK market. We're nobody in the UK market. We're pretty young. So we had to spin it off as our story, as we are molded by digital. So we're young and fresh, we're molded by digital. We are up to, up to date on trends. And basically that's the story we sold. By using us, you're always going to get the best because we are the digital generation, because all of us are quite young. So that's just, we had to sit. I love this country because the council, the government, want you to succeed as a business.
Okay.
As much as people say they take tax and everything, they do give a lot in return. We did a lot of business growth workshops. They taught me a lot about business planning.
The council did?
Yeah, Birmingham City Council.
So guys, we can go to the council and ask for business.
Every council has a growth hub.
They have a growth hub. Okay.
Well, I think so anyway. A growth hub or some sort of chamber, and their job is to support businesses in any way that they can.
Right.
The chamber, I think you pay for, but the council itself you don't, because obviously as a business you pay taxes anyway, so that kind of covers it. So.
And you know this through your mum working as a city council accountant.
No, actually, I knew it because I just needed to find out one ways I could get help.
Yeah.
So I just like, and I used to go to a lot of events. I still go to a lot of events.
Right. Cause,
like you said, the network is your network. So the more you meet people, the more they tell you, and
I like that. Access. Your network is your network.
No, it is. Because I joined the IOD a couple of years ago, and the amount of thousands of pounds of business I've gotten from there, my membership was what, 100, 200 pounds a month? I've gotten
IOD?
Institute of Directors.
There you go.
So. Just how much you pay? £200, £100 a year? Thousands and tens of thousands of business for £200 to £300 a year. All by meeting people and them introducing it to other people.
Mm.
So always attend events. Obviously, pick the kind of events you want to attend. Don't just go to any, but attend events because they open your mind up. You never know who you're going to meet there. So that was one of our main strategies, and I think it still is, networking.
Right.
So when we came back into the UK market, I had to go to a few of the councils, to the council to help me out in terms of my business plan, my processes, all those kind of things. And they did quite help a lot. They helped us to put plans in place. And then we started to do something called tendering.
Tendering?
Because government contracts are a lot more lucrative because they're worth a lot more and they last a lot longer.
Yeah.
If you win a couple of 5-6 in a year, you're all sorted. Because some of them go for like 3 years.
Yeah.
But they are very hard to win. Very hard. And these are these take a while. They're not like a standard proposal.
Yeah,
They take a while to do. But most of the time, we got through to like the last stages.
Wow.
A couple of times. So yeah, I was even shocked half the time because we're good at talking. Let's put it that way. Yeah. But we got through the last couple of times. One time, we got to the last two and we didn't win. At one stage, I was thinking, is it because I'm black or what? But I thought, you know what, let me not get into my head. It's not because I'm black.
Yeah.
Obviously, these guys who won it are probably better than us, or they've probably done it before. And that's what the council said. They said these guys have experience in these things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Even though you were a bit cheaper, they have experience, and experience always wins.
Yeah.
So I said, you know what, fine. But then after a while, it happened a couple of times. Some people had different excuses. It played in my back of my mind, is it because I'm black? But then I thought, you know what, it can't be because I'm black. I don't want it to give them that satisfaction.
Yeah.
But then this year we won our first.
Amazing.
First one, literally like 2 days into the year.
Amazing.
So I was like, yo, that was brilliant, man. And then we did about 10 in the space of a couple of months. 5 of them we got to the last stage. 5 of them we lost.
Right.
Again, some had stupid excuses, some had reasonable excuses.
What would be a reasonable excuse and what would be a stupid one?
Sometimes they say who won. So when they tell you who won, you can see that person has done exactly what they're after.
Right.
So you can't do that. There's nothing I can do about that. Because if me and you were here and this fellow went to the website for a neurosurgeon or something, we've done that. You haven't.
Mm-hmm.
So even if we're more expensive, he's going to go to us because you can trust us. So those kind of situations, I was like, fine.
Yeah.
Some, the location was a problem, so they've picked someone closer to them. Again, understandable, because they want to enrich their own council. Some were stupid, because there's one that we right next door to us. So our local government.
Right.
Or is it called local government in England? Or council?
Yeah.
I thought I was going to joke for a second. So they approached us saying, can we pitch for this project? We said yes. Pitch is fantastic. Presentation is fantastic. We were the cheapest. They called us saying somebody won because of so and so and so. I can't remember the dumb reason, but that day I was a bit angry because I thought all the feedback so far has been brilliant. We probably were better than those people, but I don't know who they know. I don't know if they've done better with them before. I don't know what it is, but that one time I strongly thought, is it because we're young black boys?
But I mean, hey, you got to give yourself credit. The fact that you've literally been in the final for quite almost every bid, as far as your story tells me.
This year, anyway.
Like, literally every bid, you've been in the final. So you must be quite good at writing these bids.
You know what? We did get... that's what... You know what? You never know. Even the negative outcomes, they always have a positive outcome.
Yeah.
Because we lost a lot, but as we lost a lot, we kept improving our writing.
Yeah, your experience.
And now, if I take this 20-30 page proposal to a private company, the job is ours, and that's happened.
Right.
Because our proposals are so in-depth right now that there's no questions they can ask that are already not in there.
They're not covered.
So right. Even though we spent wasted a year in quotation of doing these things, nowadays, it taught us a lot, number one, and now we have a solid deck that we can take to anybody. And
so amazing. So those who are listening, this is one avenue insofar as generating revenue. These government contracts, because they are
hardest.
But they are difficult, but they are worthwhile if you get them.
Definitely.
And you've got one, so congratulations.
Thank you.
So that is one aspect of money generation. And so the others, I mean, how else are you pitching, if at all?
A lot of events. So because I go to a lot of, we don't do online marketing.
Okay.
It's never, or I would say it never worked for us, but we've just never tried it because the kind of clientele we have, they're not going to just find us online. Actually, that's a lie. Someone did actually a couple of £150,000 project, and we pitched. Even though we lost, we came second. But yeah, we don't do any online advertising. Most of our strategy is we're part of a chamber, the Birmingham Chamber, part of a lot of different membership organisations.
Wow.
So the Institute of Directors, the Birmingham Chamber of Commerce, all the different around our area, the different chambers, and we just attend a lot of events, meet a lot of people, and that brings in business for us.
I mean, honestly, that sounds like one of, again, like you've echoed throughout, your network is your net worth. So if you can attend and go to all of these events, I mean, be selective because time is precious, but still.
I wasn't at the start, but eventually I had to get
there. Amazing. Okay, so I'm going to almost give you the free rein. Is there anything that you wish you knew to get you to the stage where you are? So I'm basically saying, if I was listening to this and I wanted to start my own digital agency, what should I know? What are the pitfalls? What tools? Everything you could possibly give, as much advice as you can, I'd be very grateful for, yeah.
Don't. A digital agency right now, it is so competitive. Right. As in, everybody can make a website, everybody can make an app. So, unless you're targeting a niche, so if you're targeting, you're going to do digital agency for specifically hotels, the competition has reduced a lot, so there's work for you to be done.
So be very niche.
I would say if you want to start something right now, be very niche. Mm. Pick a genre or a sector that you focus on and become industry leader or thought leader in that sector.
Right.
But again, the most likely already people in that sector doing these things. So you just have to craft, piggyback. Sometimes if you go to the right events, you can meet some of these agencies and they can give you work.
Right.
Because sometimes they outsource some things to you because they have a lot of work. So that can, again, get you in the door. But I think that's the only way to start a digital agency at the moment. Or, the other hand, you want to start a digital agency that focused on product development. So you partner with individuals or brands or startups who have ideas and you help them build that idea. But obviously, to do that, you have to be tech.
Savvy.
Yeah, so you have to be more of the tech side of things rather than the marketing side of things.
Right.
Which we are. So we don't do a lot more of marketing. We do more development and design and user interface.
Code, yeah. And like, okay.
So, and that's why we're changing our business model at the moment. We're gradually moving away from the client agency relationship, and we're developing our own digital products. We've done a few with entrepreneurs, but now we're building our own ideas.
Right.
And like I said earlier, one of them is called Cup. That is a data analytics solution for the African market, but we're going to start in Nigeria first. And that's my advice. If you're going into digital, try and develop products rather than service clients.
Yeah. So what I tend to do with a lot of my guests, Tobi, and I definitely feel like we have to get you on again. We're going to have to do part two.
We didn't cover half of this stuff we said, did
we? No, we haven't. Just because, you know, it doesn't matter because this is a conversation. But what I try to do is just, you know, do a couple of rapid fire questions. But your answers don't have to be rapid fire. But they're just nice and light, right? So would you rather your child be good looking or clever?
Clever.
Everyone says that as a default.
Because it makes sense. Like, first of all, there's always somebody for everybody in this world, I think.
Okay.
So you can be the most ugliest person in the world, but you will still find someone who loves you.
Right. All right?
And you can have the most beautiful face. And to be honest, a lot of people who are pretty don't always find happiness.
No, that's true, I guess. But beauty certainly opens a lot more doors because of the superficial world we live in, where everything's presentation more so than substance.
But there's a lot of tech developers right now who are not in or don't care about their appearance, but they have a lot of money in the bank account. They meet a lot of people. Fair. So
I always find that fascinating. I might get rid of it as a question, but
no, it's a good question. It's a good question, and I think that your intellectual property takes you longer than your beauty. Your beauty will fade eventually.
Yeah, that's true.
You can get in a car crash one day, or you can have a scratch on your face and you got a scar, and that's it.
But
your brain is the most powerful thing in the world, and if you have something in there, it will take you as far as you ever want to go.
So, in this current environment, what would you spend your last £5 on?
Oof. Ever.
Yeah, you've only got £5.
I'd give it to someone.
You would?
I would give it to someone. In the email, I said if I could do a tech talk, it would be the power of giving.
Okay.
It's, I don't know how to put it. I don't smoke or anything, but I'm pretty sure when you smoke, how you get, I get that from giving.
Right.
As in, it's, it makes you feel confident, it makes you feel good. It like releases some sort of chemical in your body that just makes you happy.
There's this gentleman called Ricardo Semler, I believe. Forgive me if I said his surname wrong, but he goes, those who give only give because they've taken too much.
No, I don't think so. I definitely haven't taken too much. No, I don't agree with that.
Okay.
I think if you give, you on because every, you can give your time. Mm. It doesn't have to be finances. As a mom, you give your children everything. So it's because you love. So if you can give, it's because you appreciate what God has made in that person or that person or that person. So you sacrificing your last £5 or your glass of water or just driving that. I remember a couple of weeks ago, end of last year, I got home. I left the office really late. It was about 11 o'clock. It was freezing. By the time I got to my car, there was ice and frost all over it. Had to go to the petrol station, just put in the petrol in the car. My hand was almost frostbite. And then I saw this gentleman. First of all, I thought it was an elderly black gentleman with crutches because the hospital's on my right and Tesco's on the left. So I thought, okay, he's going to Tesco. Let me just quickly run because it was too cold. It was just too cold. So let me quickly stop him and drive him to Tesco. I spoke to him or I tapped him. He wasn't an elderly black gentleman. He was I think it was Indian, roughly about 40s. He said he's come from the hospital. He had two crutches, so he was walking at snail pace.
Yeah.
Where he was going would have taken him 2 hours to get there, walking. And I swear he would have died that day. It was so cold. And the way he was walking, he would have froze to death. So I said, mate, get in the car. It took me 5 minutes to drive him to his house. And if you see the way he was hugging me, he said nobody would ever do that. People didn't even allow him to cross the road, as in he was just thankful. And it took me, what, two 30 pence of petrol and 5 minutes of my time? And that could have saved someone's life. So that is giving.
I get that.
It's not £5, but it's giving. And that could have changed his life. You never know.
I get that.
So
my penultimate question before asking you how we can find you and whatnot is, do you see yourself as successful and what does success look like?
Okay, success, I think, is a happy life, whatever may that might mean to you. Happy family, if that's what you want. Doesn't always have to be monetary, but just happy. So my granddad is successful. Even he was the first quantity surveyor in Nigeria. He made a lot of money, even though he lost it eventually because Nigerians went bust. But he had 5 children. They had grandchildren. He's seen his great-grandchildren. He's 85 and he still plays tennis. He still runs. He still jogs. That's happiness. His senses are fine. He's everything that he can ever think of. He has. Not just the finances. Obviously, he does have houses, but the finance-wise, it's not as it was before. But he has a family that love him. He has grandchildren that love him. He has great-grandchildren that love him. He lives in a wonderful country. He's healthy. That's success for me. So right now, overall, I am successful. But in my finances, I'm not there yet. Let's put it that way. Because I want to be a gazillionaire. So
okay.
I wouldn't say I'm not there yet.
Well, that reminds me of my other question I normally ask my guest is, well, how would you like to be remembered?
A friend to the poor. Just somebody who just loves to help people. Because I think...
Whilst also trying to pursue you to be a gazillionaire.
Okay, the way I see it, obviously money talks, money rules. If you have the money, you can make the change. Or you can still make the change while you're getting the money, but the amount of change you can make with $1 billion is not the same as with $1,000. So I still think money would make life easier for everybody. So if I had a really big company in the next couple of years, I can give people jobs.
Yeah.
When people have jobs, they have better lives. Yeah. So it is still finance that drives the majority of the change. But yes, I would want to give everything away, make people happy by giving them jobs.
To the poor, as you said.
Definitely.
So how can we find you? How can we, share, comment, review, whatever it is you want. I mean, what is it you want from us and how can we find you online?
You can find me on LinkedIn. So my name is just Tobi Oludayomi. On Twitter.
Guys, do you want to spell it out now? But I will put it in the show notes.
Oludayomi.
And Tobi is Tobi, guys.
Yes. I'm on Twitter as TobiS14. I don't really use it that much, but you can always tweet me. And I like to connect people. I like to give advice, even though I don't know what I'm talking about most of the time. But if you don't mind, I like to connect people because, like I said, I have a network. So if you need something or you know somebody that needs something, just if I have the connection, I'll make it. But yeah, that's most of my channels, really.
Amazing. Yeah. Well, honestly, Tobi, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you for inviting me.
Honestly, I feel like we definitely haven't scratched the surface, or we even barely scratched it. But if you guys...
Hey guys, we really appreciate you listening, and if you have any feedback, please leave it in the comment section below. Also, all the info about the guests, the links and the resources we speak about will be in the description below. And last but not least, please, please, please do get in touch if you can teach us how you do what it is you do. Because after all, Blacticulate is all about empowering and upskilling the community. Thanks, guys. You're the best. See you soon.